Good evening and welcome to APTN National News. I'm Brittany Hobson. Up to 1,000 supporters and protesters were outside the Grace Life Church yesterday near Edmonton. The church had been defying the province's gathering restrictions by holding indoor services. On Sunday, the church held an outdoor service after Alberta Health Services installed a fence around the building. Over 100 cars illegally parked on the nearby Enoch Cree Nation. Chief Billy Morin was there trying to redirect traffic. He says his car was kicked. He is hoping protesters stay off his nation.
The right to protest is theirs, but the right to trespass is and to come onto the nation when you're not welcomed. And there is signage there that declares that it is Enoch Cree Nation with no trespassing. They have no right to make our members, our elders, our families feel unsafe in their own homes.
Yukoners are heading to the polls today to cast their vote in the territorial election. It was called around 5 weeks ago and is the fifth election in Canada to take place during the COVID-19 pandemic. Elections Yukon states around 29,000 people are eligible to vote. Over one quarter of voters have cast their ballots during the advance polls. The Yukon Liberal Party has been in power since late 2016, winning 11 out of 19 seats during the last territorial election. The final round of hearings over a controversial iron ore mine in Nunavut started today in Iqaluit. The previous hearings in Pond Inlet were broadcast territory-wide. Now the broadcaster has been told it can't televise them. Kent Driscoll has more from Iqaluit.
Uvagut Television kicked off back in January. They broadcast mostly Inuktitut programming and are available on cable in Nunavut. In February, they broadcast public hearings from Pond Inlet, the Nunavut Impact Review Board, or NIRB, meetings. Those public meetings were happening at the same time Inuit protesters had taken over the runway and main road at the Mary River Mine. The hearings were to determine if the mine can expand. Those hearings started back up again this week, this time in Iqaluit. Uvagut asked to again broadcast the hearings and to rebroadcast some of the previous ones. This time, they were told no, despite that Uvagut's predecessor had been broadcasting NIRB hearings for years.
That's what we're trying to figure out, is what happened, because we didn't have any problems broadcasting when the technical hearings were happening, right? We've been doing this since 2012.
The NIRB tried to explain their position in a number of letters starting on April 6th. They say the hearings are so large in scale that showing a selection of the hearings doesn't show everything that's happening. They say that if people want to watch, they can request to join the Zoom call or read the transcripts. And that people testifying at public hearings have a right to privacy, despite the hearings being public. Why the sudden change? Uvagut TV has a hunch. The last hearings in Pond Inlet happened when the protesters were at Mary River, bringing a lot of attention to the NIRB.
I think that might be the reason, is that, like I said, there's too much information that is hidden, that is not talked about. And it made it to the public because of the land guardians recorded and made it to the public on Facebook. And it caught attention. And I think that might be one of the reasons.
Uvagut is still petitioning the NIRB to reverse the decision. The hearings are going on in Iqaluit for the next 2 weeks. Following those meetings, the NIRB will make a recommendation to the federal cabinet on whether to allow the mine to expand or not. And then the feds decide whether to listen to the NIRB or do something else. And at least for the time being, Nunavumiut's ability to follow the hearings depends on Nunavut's infamously bad internet connections. Kent Driscoll, APTN National News, Iqaluit.
20 days by mail. That's about how long it takes to get a passport. A status card is another story. A Government of Canada website says 16 weeks, when it often takes much longer. NDP MP Rachel Blaney is sponsoring an online petition. It aims to have status cards processed in the same time as passports. Odette Auger is a writer for Indigenews. She published an article today about the issue and joins us now. Hi, Odette. Thanks for joining us today to talk about your latest piece.
Thank you for having us.
The main character in your story, Vivian Hermanson, is collecting signatures for the online petition. What is her main motivation?
Her main motivation was to respond to the many voices and the many stories she was hearing of parents and parents-to-be and other family members who were waiting ridiculously long processing times.
Now what is
and that's despite the fact that the website said it would only take 16 weeks.
Sorry about that. There is just a slight delay. What is a consequence of not being able to get a status card on time?
Okay, well, I guess there could be a range of impacts. Not being able to access dental, health, prescriptions, specialist referrals, education, the full range of services that the status cards enable some Indigenous people to access are completely delayed, and it's not like a normal insurance company where you could pay and get reimbursed. That's not the case.
Should the blame for wait times be placed on the secure certification of status cards?
That's a good question. I did, you know, when they first came out in 2009, I did hear some, especially some of the older people, would talk about them. And they pointed out, did you notice there's an expiry date on these now? And it's not like our blood and our heritage expires. So that was a bit of a quirky thing. I think the blame the wait times is more something to do with the processes and the lack of prioritizing these identity documents. They're not being prioritized in the same way that passports are.
NDP MP Rachel Blaney has sponsored the online petition. Why did she get involved?
I believe that she's our MP here in our riding for North Island and Powell River. And I really believe that she prioritizes families' health and lack of access. And she did sponsor this petition for those reasons.
Now, as of today, the petition has just over 400 signatures, and it closes on April 25th. It needs 500 to be presented in the House of Commons. Does Blaney or Hermanson have any plans to boost that number?
Well, I think Vivian Hermanson is in the process of launching another wave of social media outreach today. And we're hopeful to reach the 500. It just speaks to many of us and our families who are struggling at this time. It's a pandemic, and some of the people are saying that they're not able to access the healthcare for their children.
Well, thank you, Odette, for sitting down with us to talk about that story. You can read that on Indigenews as well as on aptnnews.ca. Thank you again for joining us.
Okay, thank you.
Largest collection of First Nations art in the Yukon. The Yukon Permanent Art Collection includes almost 500 pieces significant to the territory's historical legacy, many of which are by Yukon First Nations artists. APTN Sarah Connors was given a behind-the-scenes look at some of the collection's most significant artwork. Here's a sneak peek.
So this is the storage vault at the Yukon Arts Center.
This vault is home to the Yukon Permanent Art Collection, funded by the territorial government.
So this piece is by Joseph Tiska. Joseph is a Kaska artist.
And home to the largest collection of First Nations art in the Yukon. Since 1981, a handful of selections are added to the collection each year, and artists are paid for their work.
This is a jacket by Shosho Esquiro.
There are 480 pieces in the collection. 41% are by First Nations artists. 300 pieces are currently in storage in this vault. The rest? Rotated throughout public buildings like this one across the territory.
You could just see the absolute perfection in her designs.
Garnet Muthing is an art curator who works with the collection. She says it's important to gather First Nations art as a way to document tradition.
Because as traditions and stories and techniques are handed down and materials are shared, there's a lot of story that's happening within those interactions. And it's really important that we're tracking all of those changes because they've evolved continually and that's still happening. And we want to have a record so that people can come and see how that's taken place within the artwork.
Some prize pieces in the collection include this figure by Tagish and Tlingit carver Kitty Smith from around the 1940s.
Very distinct.
And these earrings? Made of moose teeth.
And as far as we know, by far the first female carver in the Yukon.
So what I would have to do is use a magnifying glass just to see through it.
Ann Smith is a Kwinlandon First Nation weaver whose raven-tailed dance apron is part of the collection.
These represent shades.
She says art is rooted in tradition, and it's important for First Nations artists to contribute to collections like this so their work can be preserved for the next generations.
I try to do as much as I can today, so that way, you know, we can have answers for our children. And they will be able to know where to go.
I love the fact that the lynx, both on the mitts and on the mucklucks, are from their trap line.
Last month, the collection's new 2020 editions were revealed in this exhibit, Love in It Seems. As a way to help artists through the pandemic, the acquisition budget was doubled from $30,000 to $60,000.
Creating these figures that are like deep, thoughtful, emotive, and technical.
Aaron Corbett, the exhibit's curator, is excited about the new First Nations pieces, like this knife by White River First Nation carver Roland Peters.
He loves taking something that people don't necessarily value, don't see the beauty in, and then turning it into this beautiful object.
A lot of the weavers that I know are in Alaska or BC.
Meanwhile, Smith says she's thankful for the collection's support and how it continues to benefit Yukon First Nations artists.
We need to establish all these collections mainly because we need the art to stay here. We need the art to be here for the next generations.
Sarah Connors, APTN National News. Whitehorse.
A First Nation in New Brunswick is celebrating after winning a major national prize. More on that coming up after this short break. Welcome back. Time now for our photo of the day. The photo was captured by Michael Moore just north of Prince Rupert, British Columbia, in the Kinkolith area of the Nishka Nation. We are not sure what kind of bird that is, but it's a pretty great shot. Send your pictures of scenic special events, family celebrations, cultural events, or weather conditions to share at aptn.ca, and your photo might be our next photo of the day. Now let's take a look at tomorrow's weather forecast. Starting on the East Coast, 4 above in St. John's, 7 degrees in Halifax, 4 degrees in Happy Valley Goose Bay, 2 above in Nain, 9 in Gaspé, 14 and some sun in Quebec City, 13 degrees in Peterborough and North Bay, 7 above in Wawa, 13 in Timmins in northern Manitoba, sunny in minus 11 in Churchill, minus 2 in Pakadawagan, some snow in minus 2 in Winnipeg and Gimli, in Saskatchewan, 2 above with a mix of sun and cloud in Saskatoon, sunny skies and 4 above in North Battleford, 3 degrees in Buffalo Narrows and Meadow Lake. In northern Alberta, 9 above and some sun in Peace River and Fort McMurray, sunny skies and 6 degrees in Red Deer, 5 in Medicine Hat. Over to the west coast, 18 and some sun in Bella Coola, 9 above in Quesnel, 14 degrees in Smithers, 11 and some sun in Prince George. In the Yukon, 5 above in Beaver Creek, 6 and snow in Whitehorse. 10 above in Fort Simpson, 11 degrees in Fort Liard, minus 1 and some sun in Colville Lake, 6 above in Fort McPherson, in Nunavut, minus 18 and sunny skies in Chesterfield and Whale Cove, minus 6 in Pangerton, minus 7 and 17 in snow in Clyde River. A tragic week for Elsie Book took turn to triumph over the weekend. The New Brunswick First Nation won Crafts Hockeyville. The $250,000 prize will help rebuild the community's arena, which was damaged in a fire last September. The win comes after the community lost two fishermen when their boat capsized off the coast of Nova Scotia over a week ago. The captain, Craig Jumbo Sock, is missing and presumed drowned. He was a band counselor and helped promote Hockeyville before the accident. Kylie Francis was instrumental in the online campaign that led to beating out three other communities. She joins us now. Thanks for joining us today, Kylie. First and foremost, congratulations on winning Craft Hockeyville.
Thank you so much.
So how did your community react when the winner was announced?
So we all gathered together at the community hall. We had COVID protocols in place, so we broadcast the game live on the big screen, and the reaction of the community was overwhelming. That's something I'll remember forever, and there was tears everywhere. It was awesome.
Well, and I remember seeing it over the weekend on Twitter. There's lots of video going around, and just myself feeling very happy for you guys, seeing the reaction, lots of hugging and smiles. Did you honestly think the community would have a chance to win?
Seeing all the support coming from all over Canada, from Indigenous and non-Indigenous communities coming together for this cause, for the youth and the community of Elsie Book Took, seeing all that support, it was a big factor into thinking that we're going to win.
After the fire last fall that damaged the arena, and I guess looking at this win, I mean, how important is hockey to the community?
Hockey is a really important sport in our community. Being one of the largest First Nations communities in New Brunswick, we are the only reserve in New Brunswick with a hockey arena on reserve. So with our community coming together for something that will benefit our youth and the future generation, it's overwhelming. And, you know, hockey means so much to us, and it's great.
And so that prize money will be put towards restoring the arena. Is that correct?
Yes.
Can you explain, I guess, what did you guys do to help secure the win?
So we have a Craft Hockeyville committee. It was most of us, all community members. We got out there to promote, get the support from everybody. We rallied together and we got the win.
And I know that there has been some tragedy in the community recently. How does winning the contest change or affect, or what does it mean since the loss of Craig Jumbo Sock?
This did impact our community greatly. There was a lot of devastation, and still today it's heartbreaking. But we all came together for Jumbo. He was our counselor and an avid hockey player in the community. So we changed our game, and we said, this is for him. We're going to keep going for him. So it's.
You can certainly feel that when they announce the winner. I guess any advice for any communities out there, or any other young hockey players?
If any other communities are going to get this Craft Hockey title, we're going to be behind you 100%. Seeing all the support that we got, we're going to give it to you guys too.
All right. Thanks so much, Kylie. And again, congratulations. Thanks for chatting with us today.
Thank you so much.
Lots of people excited for Elsie Book Took's Hockeyville win, including Rogers Hometown Hockey in Cree, play-by-play personality himself, Clarence Iron. He joins us now. Thanks for joining us today, Mr. Iron. What were your thoughts when you heard a First Nation won this year's Hockeyville?
Oh, I was very excited. It was very emotional. It touched my heart. I just felt I was so excited for the First Nation to win that the Craft Hockeyville Award, and they're awarded to fix the arena. So that's good.
What does a win like this mean for hockey in a First Nation, especially for the kids there?
Well, when you don't have an arena, an arena provides a place. It's a place where people meet, the youth, the girls, the boys, and even other activities are provided in an arena. It's a multi-purpose use. It's very useful. And, even back out here, one arena had burnt not too far from where I'm at here. They still don't have an arena, and there used to be lots of activities that were held there. So it's very useful, an arena. And, when I heard that, the story of them, that their arena went down, not all down, but, it was pretty much destroyed by fire. At least, they needed help. It was severely damaged. And when I heard their story, and I thought, well, I pray and ask God that they be blessed and give him an arena. I told, ask the good Lord, give them this win so that they can fix their arena and also to have that NHL game. So yeah, it keeps children out of trouble, and it's very good there where you meet in an arena. It's good for the mind. You get physically fit. So it's a multi-purpose thing, and you come together as a community, especially in First Nations community. That's how we operate. Everybody comes there and they use the arena in different capacities.
Great. Well, thank you. It's exciting news for everyone involved, and thanks for chatting with us. We look forward to seeing you back doing Rogers Hometown Hockey play-by-play in Cree here on APTN very soon.
Yeah, bye-bye.
One of the founders of the resistance against the Dakota Access Pipeline has passed away. LaDonna Brave Bull Allard was a Dakota and Lakota historian and activist who hosted the first camp to protest the pipeline on her property in Standing Rock. The Sacred Stone Camp was started on Brave Bull Allard and her husband's property near the Cannonball and Missouri Rivers in April 2016. Opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline became a global movement, and thousands called the camps home. The fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline was at times violent, with hundreds of arrests and standoffs with law enforcement, the National Guard, and private security contractors. In an interview with APTN in 2017, Brave Bull Allard called Standing Rock a seed for a movement that had united Indigenous peoples around the world. She passed away on Saturday in Fort Yates, North Dakota, at the age of 64. Our condolences to Brave Bull Allard's family. That's all your APTN National News for this Monday, April 12th.